It's that time of the week. It is time for the Jared Bednar Show. It's presented by Audi Denver. Coach, always good to talk to you this morning. How are you?
I'm doing good. How are you guys?
Doing good, man. You know, going back to this last four-game set against Vegas, first of all, what exactly do you do when a guy like Fleury can do somersaults and cartwheels and make every save under the sun? What happens there? What's going through your head?
I was looking at that going, this could just be one of those nights. You know, I thought we had a little bit of a slow start. Like, it wasn't a complete 60-minute effort, but when you're playing a real good team, there tends to be ebbs and flows, not only just in the series, but also in the games. And then, but then I got the feeling as we went along that we were still generating some real good chances, and he just kept making all the saves. You know, at the end of the night, the scoring chances were probably just slightly in our favor if you're taking the grade A's, and you know, we end up losing 3-0. So you try to get as much traffic and screens in front of them and get your sticks on as many pucks you can to deflect them and keep putting bodies there. And, you know, we did that for part of the game or for most of the game, but, you know, he was just having a good night. And sometimes that's the way it is. You got to force him to make saves, so you got to make sure that you're putting enough pucks in traffic to him.
When did you know, Jared? Did he have that one save where you're like, okay, it's going to be one of those nights?
Well, he's always good for one or two, you know, and then he just kept them coming in this particular game. And I think it was early in the third period we really started humming along offensively, and he made, you know, a save on Belmar off the rush, and then two backdoor saves with that looked like the net were empty on Taze and Donskoy, and I was like, okay, I guess we're not getting one tonight.
Yeah. That's the way it is. Well, Vic came in the next day, Coach, and he was red hot.
I was salty.
He's mad at me.
I was salty, not because of him making the saves. It's because Moser's line. He only one line the entire night. Saved by Fleury, over and over again. Burned in my brain. I was tired of the way he called the saves.
Yeah, well, you know,
Moser needs to mix it up a little bit when it comes to
that. Right, right, right. Or, you know, he could not stand on his head like he did. Or you could score. Well, no, I'm just saying, listen, he's barrel rolling all over the place. I mean, he looked like a combination of as Pete would say, Brodeur for him, and a little Hasek mixed in as well. I mean, that's the way Fleury operates when he's really feeling good. But, Coach, I guess when I look at the four games, they bookend the four games with wins. You had the two in the middle that were wins. And I thought the Vegas performance on, you know, in game four, even Fleury threw a 3-0 shutout. I thought that you had your chances there. That's the point, is that you still were able to fight through one of their very best efforts and get really good scoring chances. If you give me seven games of that, I think that your guys are going to figure out a way. At least that's the way I feel.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I'm pretty happy with the way the series went. We were shorthanded for the first two games up in there. They pretty much had a full roster, did have a full roster, and we were able to, I mean, we lost the first game 1-0. We didn't generate as much as I would have liked. Their scoring chances were low as well. Well, kind of the same, and we created more scoring chances in game two with the limited lineup as well, with some big guys out. We add guys back in. We have a great outdoor game performance. They stepped up and played their best game of the series in game four. What I like about their team is they elevated when they needed to. Like, that was a big swing game for the series to go 3-1 or just back to, you know, what we consider not good enough, 2-2. And they found a way to get it done. We did not. When you break the game down and go one step further, yeah, we did not feel like we had the energy and the legs we needed to win that hockey game. We defended hard, but we made some mistakes, and they capitalized, and then they got a great goaltending performance. I think we can clean a couple things up out of that, and the chances are, you know, that your goaltender or the opposing team's goaltender is not going to play like that every night.
Coach Bednar with us, as he is every Wednesday. Coach, can you take us back to Saturday? And I guess a two-part question here. Number one, what was it like, that delay in between the first period to the final two? And number two, when you got out there, the beautiful setting, did you look up at the sky and say, yeah, it's a great day outside, maybe a little bit too nice?
Yeah, I was actually thinking that the day before, because we went on the ice and there was some snow. The sun was shining. It was hard to see. The ice was pretty soft for our, you know, I guess we called it a pregame skate because it was our twirl practice, you know, the day before, and it was getting a little soft. You know, I was kind of wondering about that problem or if it was going to be a problem. You know, the setting, though, was awesome. I thought the league did an amazing job sort of picking the location. The weather didn't cooperate, but I thought our guys did an amazing job rolling with the punches. Like, our guys were ready to play. They even when the ice was soft after the first period, they're like, we're in. Let's keep playing. Like, they weren't worried about it affecting our game. It was going to be the same for both teams. They handled the break great, and we came back out and had a good second and a better third to try to win the hockey game. And I like that our guys, like, stick-to-itiveness and their competitiveness. And that was a game that you could tell our guys were really focused in and trying to win. And I thought, you know, we lost a little bit of that for game four, but it was a pretty unique experience with, you know, no fans. It was quiet, but it was just like playing under the stars and two teams like battling pretty hard to go try and get 2 points. And we were able to get it done. So it was a fun experience.
So Landy says when he and Stone were talking after the first intermission, after the first period, that the Avs, you guys were ready to keep playing. Is that true? Did you guys just want to finish it in the afternoon?
Yeah, we did. Yeah, our guys, that's the sense I got from our guys the whole time. They're like, you know, it's not ideal, but let's go. Like, I think we were feeling it a little bit, and we wanted to continue. Like, we had our first period was outstanding. That was our best period of the series. We were out skating them, we were out chancing them, drawing penalties. Like, when you're a tough team to handle, you're going to get on the power play because, you know, you're going to get the calls. You're out skating guys, they start reaching, hooking, clutching, grabbing, and you get your power play time. And that's what was starting to happen. So we were putting up some good scoring chances, and we were really stingy on the defensive side of it. And I was wondering how we were going to be able to sort of maintain that or keep that pace after a break. I felt like the break favored them, but we were able to come out and still play real well and get the win.
Coach, any season is a long one in the National Hockey League, and time off is very valuable. But starting tonight against Minnesota, I mean, this schedule of yours, as we've talked about many times, gets incredibly compressed, and you guys are going to have to go. So, as a coach, what kind of adjustments are you making in this unique season that will apply maybe just to this year, or are there some things that you're learning every day, every week, that you can apply to future years for your hockey club? Tell us what it's like to go through it right now and what's coming up for you.
Well, the biggest thing is like you talked about, the schedule is managing work and rest. And, you know, you lay out a plan and then it's now changed because of COVID. Like, we've gone through the schedule. We said, listen, we're going to need extra rest. Generally, we get, you know, 1 to 2 days a week rest. We may need to ramp that up to 2 to 3 days a week, just depending, see how our minutes go with our guys. And then COVID hits, and then now it's compressed again. So you readjust again. But even after doing that, you still have to be flexible. So yesterday was scheduled full practice day. We did not skate when we traveled back from Tahoe. That threw a wrinkle in. So that was supposed to be a practice day. We took that off. Then we go out and play Vegas. And we, like I said, I didn't like our energy. I felt like we had some guys that were hurting for legs. So I asked some questions. We communicate during, after the game, how you feeling, you know, like talking to our guys. And they were sluggish. They didn't have their legs. They were having a tough time battling through. And so that tells me right away, yesterday was a scheduled practice day. And even under the circumstances, we were still going to practice and then go straight to the plane tomorrow. And we just couldn't do it. You know, I told the guys that you got to come in. You have to get your, you know, recovery work in. Everyone's got to do something in the gym. We get with our strength coaches and they plan it. And then it was an optional ice. So some guys are wanting to get out there and feel the puck. You know, some of the guys that don't play as much are going out. So we're putting assistant coaches out on the ice. Goalie coaches are working with their guys. We're giving Groovy extra rest because he's playing. playing every second night, and you're just managing it. And I don't think you look at the team as a whole either. You got to break it down into your big guns and big minute guys and your goaltender, and then some guys that aren't playing as much got to get a little extra work. And it's more individualized practice time, and the learning is done on video.
Coach, I know you've said already that Pavel Francouz is out long-term, indefinitely, right? So it's going to be a while. Yeah. Are you worried about leaning too heavily on Grubb during this time? I mean, do you guys have to make a move there?
Yeah, I don't he's feeling really good and playing outstanding, and he wants to play. As the coach and Joe and I and his goalie coach Youth are talking with Grubby all the time. The key to this season isn't going to be. It's not necessarily just the regular season. Like, we have to get clicking and playing the best we can possibly play and peak at the right time. There's no question. Like, we're not taking the regular season for granted at all, especially in a shortened season. Our division seems to be amping up. All the teams that, you know, what maybe didn't have a great year last year are really coming on with their kids and playing some really good hockey. So everyone's involved in the standings. But the key to it is us figuring out how to be playing our best and still be rested and have our guys healthy for the playoffs. Last year, we come in healthy after the long rest, and we didn't survive. You know, the injuries and stuff just started piling up. And we don't want to get in that situation again. And I don't know that we can, you know, that I'm able to control it or Joe is able to control it. But we're certainly putting our heads together to try to do the best we possibly can to set us up. And part of that will be managing Grubby's ice time and figuring when we can get him real quality, like 2 and 3 day rest, and then get him back playing a bunch of games in a row. And other goalies are doing it right now. Fleury's doing it for Vegas. So there's no reason why he can't play a lot. Vitek Vanek's doing it in Washington. I think he just played 12 of the last 13. You know, there's guys doing it and just managing their rest. And we've been working with Grubby on that already for weeks.
It's Jared Bednar. Last thing for you, Coach. We have 30 seconds left. I want to play a piece of audio for you from the outdoor game on Saturday. This is Petrangelo when he sees McKinnon just touch the puck in your own end.
Oh, boy.
When you have a player that instills that fear by just touching the puck, how does that feel?
Well, it's good. I mean, you can see him wind it up there, and you know what? That just tells you too, though, how good of a player that Petrangelo is, and why he was the captain of a Stanley Cup team. Because he sees the speed Mac gets right away, and he's like, his awareness is so good, right? Like, he's already like, oh, this is going to be tough, and he's 5 seconds away from engaging Mac on this play, and he already knows that when he's winding up like that and he gets that puck in that ice, he's going to be tough to handle, and he was. You know, he puts it by, beats both Petrangelo and Fleury. So, you know, it was interesting. I saw that, and I was like, man, he said that early. And, you know, just shows great awareness, you know.
For the record, Coach, when I see Moser's face before the show starts, it's usually an oh boy that follows.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
It's Coach Bednar.
And then it gets into, oh man, as our one hits, and then, oh my God, is our two hits. You know how it goes, Coach.
Coach, always appreciate your time. Thanks so much, and good luck tonight.
All right, thank you, fellas. Take care.
There you go. Jared Bednar, presented by Audi Denver, our conversation.
And we could sit here and talk to Jared for an hour about this Avalanche team, because there are things that do need to be addressed. I mean, the Avs roll for their last 16 in the power play.
Yeah.
You've got to get more. Well, because he was very thorough with his answers, and, okay, you know, now we got to get to a break.
We do. Quick break. Back in 3 minutes.